नमस्ते लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, इंडिविजुअल्स इन वेरियस डोमेन्स। इन माय प्रीवियस वीडियो आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट वेरियस कांडास लाइक अरण्यकांड, various kandas like jnana kanda, brahma kanda, upasana kanda and karma kanda, and then was talking about storyline that comes from brahadaranyaka, aranyakas, samhitas, brahmanas, and I was even talking about the earlier part of Vedas, which were more or less based on the real words by the universe or the Shruti. It's only after 10,000 years, maybe like we can say like 4,000 years before this 21st century, whatever that was there have been written. However, unfortunately, since they were based on the Shruti or direct inference from the sky, some part of it was missing. Let's take this subject further. Upanishads were considered as Jnana Kanda approximately 5,000 years back. Though I may be wrong with my numbers, please do kindly forgive me. In case if anyone has the accurate number, please do make sure to let me know in my comments, in whatever comments that you want to give. Kindly forgive me for the same. Whatever numbers that I am giving is the approximate number, though I would not really know about it. But then, just to give the glimpse of the period, I am just going back, giving you the information as such. Now, at the same time, during that period of time, there was Vedantic philosophy, which were in Vedantic philosophy, there were two types of people. One were Astic and other were Nastic. Astic had a typical attitude of all are one. Nastic had a typical attitude of not all are one. Na asti ekam. Now, let's then came the belief system into picture. When I say belief system, society during that period of time was not really like so crowded as it is in 21st century. And the civilization, as I always keep on telling, Indic culture, Indus Valley civilization, Hadappa civilization, Harappa Mohenjo-daro civilization, all these civilizations were having limited number of people. Now, one may ask me a question. You have been talking about universe creation, about Prakriti and Purusha. Yes, I was talking about Prakriti and Purusha. Now, why are we not talking about that? Even before that, Prakriti and Purusha understanding, one needs to really understand what is this all about and why Nastik and Astik came into picture and why this belief system really existed. This is one of the factors, or you can say it as cofactors as well, for Natya Shastra or Shastra to evolve. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the brief introduction that I am talking about. I didn't still get into the subject, but still I want to give the clear-cut information on as to why the emergence of Natya Shastra came. Why this Natya concept came. Okay, now coming to the point, as I was speaking, Nastik and Astik. Astik was the one who thinks all are one. Nastik was the one who was thinking not all are one. However, when the universe was created, sorry about that, when the universe was created, individual was supposed to be created, right? To enjoy the beautification or to enjoy the nature, right? So he had to create human body. He cannot create the human being without any qualities. Am I correct? So, sorry about that. He had created the human body or the individual irrespective of gender, be it masculine or feminine, with five innate qualities of life, that is desire to live, desire to know, desire to happiness, desire to power, and desire to peace. So these were a few pointers which he had to, creator had to understand. And now, desire to live, when you are desiring to live, you need to have some limitations, right? You just cannot live just like that. Am I correct? So there has to be some kind of system or the scheme involved in it. Now, coming to the point of desiring to know, what one should know, what kind of knowledge one should be knowing or understanding is one point which most of us need to understand. And this is what is called Shashvata Satya, desire to happiness. Exactly when do you get happiness? When you know, when you are doing something good. How do you justify that this is good and this is bad? However, there was nothing like good or bad, which one needs to understand. The point is, we have to really think in a more broader perspective and vivid aspect about this. Desire to power. What is this power's definition? Why seers or rishis or munis talking about this when he or she has created? Ladies and gentlemen, crux of the subject is power does not mean you misuse whatever power that has been given, that has been practically proven in Mahabharata and Ramayana. In Mahabharata, just because Arjuna had the power or whatever intelligence power, whatever it is, he failed literally when the war started. Understand this. This is where the power concept comes into picture. And even before, when Sri Krishna was explaining to Arjuna the Bhagavad Gita concept, this was there in Vedas and Upanishads, in Shastras. This was coexisting for a longer period of time, for centuries and centuries. As I was telling, Shruti, in the form of Shrutis. Now, in the form of Smritis, Rishis and Munis had to create that, right? So they had to write that in a literal sense. Desire to peace. This is what is called Dharmo Rakshati Rakshitaha. Now, desire to peace means a person would be peaceful unless and until he clears, or he is very much clear with the negative thought processes. Understand this. This is what is the crux of the subject. And most importantly, we tend to have the, this is what is the very important aspect of Natya Shastra or the Shastras. The basic output of the subjective or the objective aspect of Natya Shastra is to produce this aspect. Ladies and gentlemen, understand this. Now, so far I was talking about the innate qualities of life and all. Who should have this? Of course, I have told human beings, human existence and all. So, human body will have all these innate qualities of life by default. But then, limitations are always there. When I say limitations, it's as per structure and as per scheme. Now, at the same time, self cannot be realized by self. So there has to be someone who guides him or her. What are those doctrines? Again, Shastras. The basic point of getting into Shastras. Now, for these mediators are Shastras and Guru Tattva. When I say Shastras, only Guru can teach those Shastras. Shastras are the structured and schematic way of understanding the subject conceptually. At the same time, one needs to understand that Tathya Jnana cannot be attained. When I say Tathya Jnana, it's the hidden knowledge. When I say hidden knowledge, the deeper study or the in-depth analysis of the objective part, which has to be attained by one and all. And this is one of the core concept of Natya Shastra. By the by, time and again I am telling, this is just a brief introduction that I am giving. The base of Natya Shastra as to what one needs to understand or one needs to learn or what was the emergence situation. Okay, now the other part which one needs to understand is Maya and Mahamaya. What is this Maya that rishis, munis or Brahma rishis are talking about? What are these Mahamayas? However, here again, the catch to the point is study of the astrotropical objects, astro objects. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen, how deep Natya Shastra is all about. Natya Shastra's factors and cofactors, even before establishing it as a doctrine, what was the reason for Natya Shastra to be provided as a doctrine to the individual? When I say doctrine, it is people are taking it as an entertainment aspect or as a doctrine for the dancer to understand. No sense of whatever structure or scheme is involved, but basic phenomena behind all of these are the following, these pointers. And this again goes to Daityas and Adityas. Sorry about that. This again goes to Daityas and Adityas. See how beautifully, you know, the background of Natya Shastra is. The very purpose of Natya Shastra's in-depth analysis and the deeper study is so much involved in it, ladies and gentlemen. Now, apart from these, if you see the evolution of Daityas and Adityas were existing 10,000 years back only, but in the Shruti form. Now they will have to make it in the Smriti form. However, the spiritual and philosophical advancement to the highest level, has been studied in the deeper and in-depth aspect. Sorry about that. Though one may say that they are not able to break the genetical and hormonal codes, Today's 21st century scientists are not able to break the codes of genetical and hormonal codes. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. But rishis, munis and brahma rishis had that tenacity and authenticity to break that code and get into that. And this is the beauty of Natya Shastra. Apart from being used as dancers' guidelines or the dancers' doctrine, it has so much in-depth meaning. It again talks about the tens and billions of stars from the astronomy point of view, as our body is filled with all kinds of stars and planets. Now, here is the very interesting point. I was talking about Shastra Tattvas and Guru Tattvas, right? If one understands Shastra Tattvas and Guru Tattvas, only then he can act as a mediator, right? And that is one reason why Natya Shastra is the culmination of four Vedas: Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Atharvana Veda, Sama Veda. Though all of these came after the pre-era or after the 10,000, the thing that I am talking about were initially in the form of voice from sky, or we can say it as Shruti. It's the Shruti that came. They were not properly put in structure or documented, well documented. It's only after 10,000, that 10,000 years, when rishis, munis and brahma rishis found that this is the emergency situation. Changes would happen every now and then for 500 years. Today, things are changing like this for every second. Hormonal therapy has come into picture. Male is getting converted to female. Though this was existing in the medieval era also, but they had a different kind of phenomena, which I may not be able to explain because I don't have the proper documented. Once I have, I can explain you about this also. So all of this, whatever that I am talking so far, are the factors and cofactors or the pointers, key pointers for Shastra to exist initially. So the moment one gets into this form, he or she will be able to get in touch with the positive souls. Positive souls or the positive source points, or we can say planets. And this is the beauty of dance. And that's when Navanida Bhakti came into picture. Bhakti Tattva was born there. How do you show this? Again, in the Navanida Bhakti, meditation is there, yoga therapy is there, and dance is there, music is there. Understand this, ladies and gentlemen. This is the very, very, very important point which a dancer needs to understand. Even before dancing, learning dance, one needs to understand about the shastras, why they had come. These are just the pointers that I am trying to explain you for the existence of Natya Shastra as a doctrine. Even before understanding Natya Shastra, Shastra has to be understood. These Shastras are to be understood. Understand this. These are the key pointers or the pointers that I have spoken about so far for the Natya Shastra specifically. Thus, I conclude this video with a positive note. Key pointers being understanding the five innate qualities of life: desire to live, desire to know, desire to happiness, desire to power, desire to peace, and understanding Yoga Maya and Mahamaya, and then understanding who are the mediators for this, who are Shastras, and understanding Guru Tattvas, and understanding Tathya Jnana as a whole. Remember this, ladies and gentlemen. My only goal to do all these videos is educate one and all and give them that kind of knowledge which would be helpful for someone to grow near to personality. I appreciate one and all to please forgive me in case I have spoken anything wrong. Your comments are really valuable. I am also a human being. I also commit mistakes. Please do kindly let me know. Thus I conclude this video with a positive note. Stay blessed. Have a blissful life. May the Guru's grace be with all. Have a nice day ahead. May the Guru's grace be with you. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.